My name is Rebecca Sims, and in 1986, I went to work for Robert Corson, who owned Vision Bank Savings and, along with his mother, controlling interest in Westside National Bank. I went to work for them as their personal controller, and I was primarily involved in handling their real estate taxes.
And how long did it go on before you discovered that something wasn't exactly right, that in fact you were working for somebody who, for instance, Pete Brewton has referred to as a mule for the CIA, who was moving money, large sums of money around, was involved in money laundering, and was connected to organized crime. Tell us how that evolved.
Well, I wasn't aware when I went to work for them, nor really for about the first year of my employment there, that anything that they were doing was illegal per se. It was strange that while everyone else in Houston and as well as in Texas was trying to live through the rise or the fall of the real estate industry, Robert Corson and his mother continued to make money. So that was strange. It was also strange that around the 1st of 1987, one of the Dallas newspapers put out the grand jury subpoena list, and a large number of Corson's friends were on that list. Little things were happening, little things that didn't add up, but I didn't know to look for anything wrong, so I wasn't looking for it. By around the summer of 1987, I began to really have doubts about Corson and his mother and the type of business they were doing. But it really wasn't until after I left their employment that I learned of anything really illegal.
What were you doing before you went to work for Corson?
I had my own business. I was a controller by the hour, and I handled people's taxes who made large sums of money and needed to have their federal income tax monitored on a monthly basis. The majority of my clients were in the real estate industry, so when I got the call from Corson's organization asking me to come in and talk to them, they were kind of like a godsend, because a lot of my clients had really kind of pulled in and could see what was about to occur in the marketplace. So my specialty has always been real estate taxation.
So you're familiar with various, with the way in which financial operations take place, tax operations. You had a good amount of experience there when you finally went to work for Robert Corson.
Oh, I had about 11 years in real estate. I know real estate backwards and forwards. I know what it's supposed to be. I know how closings occur. I know what should occur. And so by the time I came to work for Corson and Garman, I knew exactly what I was doing, and I had a very good reputation.
Now, talk about some of the things that started to seem strange after a while, some of the things that happened that raised doubts in your mind about what was going on there.
Well, one of the things that raised doubts in my mind, one of the major things, was that in the summer of 1987, I happened to go into the boardroom shortly after a board meeting had taken place, and a list of REOs, which are real estate owned, this is repossessed property that the SNL owned, I happened to look over at that list, and I was horrified because a couple of pieces of the property were adjacent to property that Corson had received in some really questionable real estate transactions. Real estate transactions that I couldn't totally understand how they occurred, and when I would have a question, I would be given an answer, but they just weren't totally kosher. Something always seemed to miss with them. I, for a long period of time, attributed the lack of, say, a complete closing file to the actual business practices of Corson and Garman rather than to look for something that was devious or illegal. I just didn't expect it. I had never been in that situation before.
Now, I don't understand. There were properties that were adjacent to. I'm not sure what would be significant about that.
Well, what would be significant is when I looked at these properties, when I looked at the list of REOs, I realized that these were loans made around the same time that Corson was receiving economic benefit from the borrowers of the loans at Vision Bank, and that is an impropriety. I mean, without full disclosure, it's in violation of federal, rules and regulations.
You can explain that a little bit further.
Well, it's a conflict of interest. The property, the people who had borrowed money from Vision Bank had turned around, and for virtually no money, Corson had been able to acquire very valuable property. And the fact that it was adjacent and that it was the same players led me to believe that there had been some sort of wrongful act.
Okay. So you began to become suspicious about what was going on. What happened next? How did this sort of evolve until you finally left?
Well, a couple of things happened. I was asked to do a couple of things that I just could not do. With having two teenage children and being at home trying to teach your children the difference between right and wrong, being asked at the office to disregard those values, I just couldn't do it.
What were the things that you were being asked to do?
Well, in a very broad sense, I was asked to commit tax, bankruptcy, and bank fraud, which I guess that was like within a period of 4 months. And so in October of 1987, I quit. I just walked away from my job.
And then how did you go from accountant sort of tax consultant to investigator who has worked in one way or another in conjunction with government investigations? How did it evolve that you became an asset, if you will, for investigators looking into, say, Robert Corson and Vision Bank?
Well, shortly after I left Corson and Garman, I was told by a couple of my friends who happened to be attorneys that even though I had done nothing wrong at Corson and Garman, the fact that I had been their controller would cause the FBI to eventually show up at my front door. I mean, this is the fall of 1987 when it was known as the FBI scare. All the SNL and bank owners were finding themselves subjects or targets of FBI investigations. And my friends were telling me that it would cost me somewhere in the neighborhood of $15,000 for legal counsel to prove that I hadn't done anything wrong. And I thought that was ridiculous. So I contacted the FBI. I didn't feel like I could go to a new position with a new company with this baggage hanging over my head. When you're someone's controller, when you're their accountant, you become very intimate with that person. That person has to more or less bare their bones to you. And I felt that it would not be fair to any new employer to develop that type of intimacy and then have the FBI show up one day to want to talk to me. So, being quite naive, I said, well, I'll contact the FBI, and I'll tell them what I know, and they can arrest Corson and put him in jail, and then I can go on with my life. But it didn't happen that way. It didn't happen anything like that. And within a very short period of time, a period of about 4 or 5 months, it became very evident that Corson had some sort of Teflon coating. And I was shocked. I mean, I couldn't figure out what was going on. I couldn't, you know, one moment the special agent in charge is saying, I've got 21 counts of bank fraud against him. I'm writing up my report. It's going to Washington. We've got a grand jury on its way. And the next thing you know, the special agent in charge of the case is transferred. Other things started happening. I found that the FBI here in Houston had lost all interest in Corson. By this time, economically, my world had turned upside down. I had gone from $7,300 a month to zero a month. And I was sitting there looking at my children going, but look, I didn't do something that I would be ashamed of. You know, I did what was right. And my kids are going, but the bad guys are getting away with it. And I didn't know about the details of the Department of Justice or how a grand jury works. I didn't know any of these things.
Did you ever try and confront the FBI? Hey, what's happening? What happened to our case? What happened to my agent? Why is this man not being prosecuted?
Well, yes, and in rose-colored glasses, when I was given an answer, I believed it. I was told that initially when I first learned that the special agent in charge had been transferred, I asked who was in charge of the case, and I was told that agent was still in charge of the case, which was not true, but that's what I was told. Well, when I could see that nothing was going to happen with the FBI, I said, this is bull. I've got to get to the bottom of this. I've never, you know, this isn't the way it happens in the movies or television. So I called the state of Texas Savings and Loan Commission, and I talked to the chief enforcement officer there. And I told him that you know, who I'd work for, and that I had some information that I felt he would like to have, and he and I made an appointment, and I drove up to Austin to meet with him. Well, a period of about 5 days elapsed between the time I talked to the gentleman and the time I arrived in his office, and by the time I got to his office, it was a totally different person, and all he kept saying to me was, the state of Texas can't protect you. And I'm thinking, what the fire is going on? What do you mean the state of Texas can't protect me? Why do I need to be protected? And he wouldn't say. But he suggested that I get in touch with someone who might be able to give me a little bit more understanding as to why the state of Texas could not help me. At the same time, he told me that he would see to it that the documentation that I had given him would be delivered to the Federal Home Loan Bank Board, which is now known as the Office of Thrift Supervision. So I said, okay, and I came back to Houston, quite confused at how someone who had been so anxious to get this information all of a sudden felt that this information was somewhat of a hot potato.
Now, who was this that you were talking to, and what did he recommend that you do? He said he could give you, recommend that you speak with somebody who could inform you a little bit more. Who are we talking about, and what was his recommendation?
Well, his recommendation was that I get in touch with the former president of Vision Bank Savings. And the person at the Texas Savings and Loan Commission was a gentleman by the name of Art Leiser. And so I did that. When I got back to Houston, I called this person, and this person referred me to an attorney who had a private investigator and on his staff. And within the very same day, that private investigator had driven up from Kingsville to Houston, which, realize how big Texas is, that's a major feat, to meet with me. And we sat down. This is like the end of August 1988. First of August 1988.
Now, let me get this straight. The man who works for the state of Texas in charge of savings and loans...
Enforcement
said, first he was anxious to meet with you and hear your story. When you got there, he wasn't so anxious. He recommended that you go back and speak with the former president of Vision Bank, which was also Robert Corson's bank.
Right. Corson had purchased Vision in March of 1986. So this is the person who was president prior to Corson purchasing Vision Bank. So that's what I did. And the gentleman came to Houston.
And what was his name?
I don't want to give that out. There's a lot of reasons for that. The gentleman came to Houston and sat down with me and proceeded to tell me that my former employer had been an asset for the CIA since 1975. I thought this guy had lost it. I thought this was the biggest bunch of bull I had ever heard of in my life. What? You know, I worked for these people. How could this be? And he and I spent a couple days together. And I thought, this is going to be very, very quick. I'm going to be able just to, you know, blow him right out of the saddle. This was the most bizarre thing I'd ever heard of in my life.
Did he say more than just an asset? Did he say some of the things he was involved in? Could you talk about that?
Well, he basically said that Corson had been involved in the movement of money and negotiable instruments, and that Corson had made many trips to Central America, and that it had begun approximately in 1975, and that Corson's mother had also been active in it. And he gave me specific dates where he knew that either Corson or his mother had been out of the country. And I keep, as an accountant, I keep a very detailed diary. And I said, oh, this is going to be easy. I'm just going to go back and I'm going to find that they, you know, they were here in Houston. This is bull. Well, lo and behold, the harder I tried to disprove the man, the more apparent it became that there might be some credence to what he was saying. He explained to me then that he had already met with Richard Breneke, and that Breneke had known Corson since 1975.
Richard Breneke is the Portland-based arms trafficker who has done extensive contract work with the Central Intelligence Agency, with the Mossad, and has given some very interesting details about, shall we say, a drugs-for-guns operation that moved in and out of Texas.
I don't know that I would call Dick an arms trafficker. I would say Dick is a financial wizard. Which is one side of Richard Breneke that I don't think very many people have ever focused on. And it was that element of Dick that Robert Corson was involved with. I had no earthly idea who Richard Breneke was. I didn't know him from Adam. I didn't know anything about the CIA. Except that it was, you know, the Central Intelligence Agency. So I talked to this gentleman, and I took notes. At the time, I had an attorney who I was working with, because I had wanted to file a civil RICO suit against Corson when I could see that time was dragging out and my life was going to be affected by what had happened during my employment with Corson and Garman, I felt that I had standing, and so did this attorney. So when I learned of this, I immediately contacted this attorney, who is Marion Rosen here in Houston. And we made an appointment, and I go in, and I start talking about guns for drugs and money laundering and what have you. And
well, how did you learn some of those details? Who told you about guns for drugs and money? And tell me, explain how you have that information came to
you. The person that I met with, the person that I spent a couple of days with, that had come up from Kingsville. And it had been relayed via Richard Breneke.
Okay, so this is the person who you were introduced to by the former president of Vision Bank. Just explain to me what this guy who worked with Vision Bank said to you about Corson and exactly what he was doing.
Well, what I was told that Corson was doing was moving negotiable instruments, literally. I mean, that may sound real simple, but it's not. He was laundering money and facilitating the funds for covert activities and for primarily off-the-shelf activities of the agency. Most people think that that means the Contra network, but that's not necessarily so. Off-the-shelf activities occur throughout the world, and it takes a lot of money to be able to fund one of these operations. Corson was a facilitator of the funds. There was a corporate entity known as International Fund for Mergers and Acquisitions, IFMA. I was told that Corson was involved with that company. I have since learned that company, IFMA, was somehow related to Mike Harari in Panama City, the Mossad agent that was very closely related to Manuel Noriega. At any rate, I...
And these negotiable instruments, are we talking about weapons?
No, you're talking about money. You're talking about bearer bonds. A bearer bond is a certificate, a stock certificate that has no name written on it. It's like a zero coupon bond where you clip off your little interest due and you walk in and it's pay to the bearer. It's a very easy way to launder money because there's no paper trail. I was told that Corson was also involved in the trafficking of drugs and that he was involved with flying instruments down, negotiable instruments down, whether it's cash or bearer bonds or whatever, to Central America, and on the return flights, there were drugs coming back up.
And this is something that Breneke talked about, and actually this is something that he said that he told me that he attempted to inform Donald Gregg, who was then the National Security Advisor for the Vice President of the United States, who was then George Bush. Now, I just want to be clear here. The person who was informing you, what was his position in relation to Corson and Vision Bank?
He had no relationship. He was a private investigator that worked for a law firm in Kingsville that the law firm was representing the former president of Vision Bank. Corson, within 6 months after Corson purchased Vision Bank was in regulatory capital problems. Vision was eventually taken over by the federal government in March of 1989. During about a period of 3 months, Corson made in excess of $45, $50 million worth of sham loans, in my opinion, to his buddies. And in my opinion, once again, to cover up what Corson did at Vision Bank, he filed a civil RICO against the former owners of Vision, stating that they had not fully disclosed the economic condition of Vision prior to his purchase of Vision Bank. And for all practical purposes, that's a smokescreen. Corson bought Vision and raped it immediately. The alleged wrongdoing in Corson's civil RICO against the former owners is minute.
How did this private investigator know about the activities of Robert Corson? How did he tell you that he learned all this?
Well, aside from being a private investigator, the gentleman is a retired special agent from the U.S. Treasury Department. He had been with the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs. He had been with Customs. And he was a law enforcement officer. And aside from Richard Breneke, he had interviewed a number of other people. And there was no doubt, but that, in his opinion at that time, but that what Breneke had to say was very valid.
And what is his name?
Who?
The private investigator.
I don't want to give his name.
You don't want to give his name?
No.
What about the law firm that was representing the former president of Vision Bank?
It was Nelson Sharp. Sharp, Kruger, and I don't remember. It was just a law firm in Kingsville.
Rebecca Sims, we've heard that you were informed by various people about the fact that Corson was deeply involved as a conduit, an asset for the Central Intelligence Agency, that he was involved in as a carrier, a launderer of money, a carrier of money around Central America, that he was involved in arms trafficking, in drugs. But you didn't just hear this from this one person in relation to Vision Savings Bank. Then Richard Breneke sort of came into your life. Let's talk about Richard Breneke and how he threw light on what you were hearing from these other sources.
Well, within a couple of weeks after I met with the private investigator from Kingsville, I contacted Richard Breneke, and I asked him if I could meet with him, and we made arrangements to meet midpoint between Houston and Portland, which was obviously Denver.
Now, explain to people why, make the connection once again. How did Richard Breneke come into this? Why are you then meeting with him again?
Well, the person that I had talked with concerning Robert Corson's relationship to the CIA had said that one of his sources was Richard Breneke. And I didn't know anything about Mr. Breneke, but I decided I would find out about Mr. Breneke. And within a couple of weeks, I got in touch with Mr. Breneke. So I asked him if I would come on up to Portland, if he would meet with me. And he said yes. And so I spent the better part of a week up with Richard Breneke in Portland, Oregon. And I can say that during my entire time there with Dick, and with all the information that Dick has provided me, seldom does Dick have a total picture of what has transpired. I haven't been interested in chasing guns or weapons or things like that. I've been interested in what my expertise is, and that is the financial end of it. I have yet to come across information, though it may be raw, that Dick Breneke has provided me that was wrong.
Now tell me and tell the listeners what exactly you learned in that week with Richard Breneke, what kind of information did he have that you found compelling in terms of this man, Robert Corson, former owner of the failed Vision Bank in Houston, who apparently was a mule, as Pete Brewton has referred to him, a man who transported large amounts of money around the continent, who was apparently an asset for the Central Intelligence Agency, who was involved in all this other stuff. What about Breneke confirmed what you learned from the private investigator who was working with the former president of Vision Bank?
Okay. One of the things, right up front, I asked Richard Breneke, how did he meet and where did he meet Robert Corson? Breneke said that somewhere around 1975, his first meeting with Robert Corson had been inside a lobby of a bank in downtown Houston. And he said it was the most unusual bank because there was a large Texas-styled mural on the wall, painted on the wall. Well, he was describing the Niels Espersen bank lobby of Allied Bank of Texas. Allied Bank of Texas was controlled by Walter Mischer, who was Robert Corson's former father-in-law. You can't describe something that is no longer there unless you have seen it. Of all the banks in downtown Houston, the probability of Richard Breneke making this up out of thin air is very remote.
What's the significance that he was in this bank one day and he saw this this mural? What's the big deal?
This was the first time that he met with Robert Corson. This is when they bonded their relationship concerning the International Funds for Mergers and Acquisitions. He was introduced to Robert Corson by Walter Mischer. According to Mr. Breneke, Walter Mischer was the owner of a landing strip out in West Texas that was used for the guns for drugs operations of off-the-shelf activities of the CIA, as well as for training rebels from Central America.
These were the Contras.
The Contras.
Now, let's just be very clear. We're talking about, we've gone from Robert Corson, who was formerly the son-in-law of Walter Mischer. We're talking about Walter Mischer, who is a large landowner in Texas, who essentially owns his own town, Lajitas. And tell us more about why it's significant that Walter Mischer would have an airstrip, as alleged by Richard Breneke, that's involved in a drugs and guns operation for the Contras.
Walter Mischer is probably one of the most powerful Texans today. He is a mover and shaker behind the scenes in both political parties. He reportedly is a close friend of President George Bush. He is a very close friend of Senator Lloyd Benson. He
Isn't it true that, in fact, Lloyd Benson's campaigns, major political campaigns, were virtually run in the same office of Walter Mischer?
That's correct. During Lloyd Benson's last senatorial campaign, his Houston office was run out of Mischer's offices.
Benson's campaign office was the same as Mischer's Houston office.
That's correct. That's the fall of 1988.
And Mischer, it is reported, or what do we know Is there an indication that Mischer and Corson worked together on various business deals?
Well, this is one of the bizarre things. During the time in which I worked for Robert Corson, I was aware that Walter Mischer was his former father-in-law, but I was told emphatically many times that Corson and Mischer had nothing to do with one another, and that, in fact, Mischer and Corson did not even speak. When Richard Breneke told me that Mischer and Corson did work together, I found that very hard to believe until I came back to Houston and started talking to some of my confidential informants. In fact, BJ and Walter Mischer had made at least one trip to Belize together.
BJ is Corson's mother.
BJ Garman, I'm sorry, yes, it's Corson's mother.
And she's really the power there in that family, or she has been.
Yeah, she's quite a powerhouse. She's a very dynamic woman. Getting back to my meeting with Richard Breneke and some of the things that he started telling me, I knew that Robert Corson was a very active gambler. I knew that Robert could drop a great deal of money in Las Vegas. Richard Breneke discussed with me some of the Las Vegas connections, basically to organize crime that Robert Corson appeared to have.
What do you know, for instance, about Ronald Martin? Walter Mischer, for instance, or Robert Corson, and the armed supermarket that was based in Panama?
Well, one of the things that Richard Breneke told me, and then in the spring of 1989, Pete Brewton and I both went back to Portland and spent another week with Dick. One of the things that we've been told is that Ron Martin originally had been a fence salesman for Sears and Roebuck, and that when he got into the arms network, it was through the purchase of some Chilean Lend-Lease guns, U.S. Lend-Lease guns to Chile, and that in order to consummate that initial gun transaction, it had been Allied Bank of Texas, Walter Mischer's bank, who had given Ron Martin a bridge loan so that he could buy the guns from the Chilean officials, or rebels at the time, and then turn around and sell them.
This is essentially what led to the overthrow of Allende we're talking about now.
That's correct.
Okay, now give us a little bit more background on who Ronald Martin is.
Ronald Martin is one of the owners of the Tamiami Gun Shop and was part of a group known as the Armed Supermarket Group. He was involved with Mario Delamico out of San Pedro Sula, Honduras.
Essentially, we're into a situation in which we have Walter Mischer, we're talking about, according to Breneke and information related to what Breneke has been talking about, that you have Walter Mischer, who is a major landowner in Texas, a close friend of George Bush, reportedly a close friend of Lloyd Benson. Lloyd Benson is running for vice president and senator at the same time, and his Houston office is in Walter Mischer's office. And we're talking about Walter Mischer, this banker, who is a former, at least we know he was formerly a partner of Robert Corson, and Corson is his son-in-law. Corson married his daughter. We have this man funding Ronald Martin, who's involved in what has been called the armed supermarket, which is involved in drugs for guns, which is involved in an operation that supported the overthrow of Salvador Allende. What else do we know about these connections between major bankers and Ronald Martin and Walter Mischer and other subversion. What else have you learned?
Well, I've also learned that though we can't confirm it at this point, we have reason to believe that Walter Mischer was allowing mercenaries to be trained on his property in Lajitas. We also have been told that at least one person came across this operation. This person has absolutely nothing to do with Richard Breneke. This person has nothing to do with spook chasing or investigating. This person stumbled across this operation going on. The general vicinity is the same area of where this landing strip was located. I don't know if Pete told you this, but during my second meeting, our second meeting with Dick Breneke, Dick sat down and drew a very sketchy type map of where this landing strip was.
On Mischer's property.
On Mischer's property. Well, it wasn't really, it's adjacent to Mischer's property. When Pete and I came back to Houston, Pete obtained satellite photos, and with stereoscope glasses on the dining room table, we began to put this together and located the runway. Shortly thereafter, Pete traveled down to Lajitas and physically located it with all the burn piles and mesas that exactly were where Dick Breneke had told us they were. It was obvious something had been there. The runway was 6,000 feet long. In interviewing people around that area, Pete was told that C-130 cargo planes were taking off and landing at that airstrip. And even the when Pete got into the real property records to find out who owned the landing strip and started contacting the owner of the property, the person who had installed the landing strip, it was all very vague. A little old lady in Florida owns the property, but she didn't pay for the runway, but she knew the runway was there. The gentleman who constructed the runway said a man in Houston paid for it, but he couldn't remember who that man was. It's a very, very bizarre situation. But it was adjacent to Walter Mischer's property. The fact that Breneke thought it was Mischer's, I think, is very significant. I think it also, not being on Mischer's property, allows for plausible deniability.
That was Rebecca Sims, and as you heard, she got caught in the crossfire of a situation that brought her face to face with a longtime CIA mule, a man who moved money for the Central Intelligence Agency, and somebody who had all kinds of strange connections with the agency, with the banking community, and with the power elite in this country. We're going to be pursuing that story in the weeks and months to come.
You have been listening to Deep Throat of CIA SNL Fraud, an interview with Rebecca Sims by Pacifica programmer Dennis Bernstein. To obtain a tape cassette of this program with Rebecca Sims or others in the SNL / In Loot series, call Pacifica Radio Archive at 800-735-0230. That's 800-735-0230.